Do you want to know what really happened in the mass extinction at the end of the Cretaceous that devastated the dinosaurs and allowed us mammals to dominate the Cenozoic era? Well, in today's video, we are going to be going over all the information that the rock record gives us about the environmental and climatic state of Earth during this time in Earth's history and the events or major event that led to the beginning of the end for the dinosaurs and many other animals during the Cretaceous. This extinction event is called the KT or KPG extinction, depending on whether you call it the Cretaceous Tertiary or Cretaceous Paleogene boundary. Either way, it was a major mass extinction event, one of the big five that I talk about in my extinction video. I'll link it up here to the top right if you want to check that out, in which the following groups of organisms were hit super hard. Coccolithophores, those little nanoalgae guys that made the major chalk deposits in the Cretaceous that gave the Cretaceous its name, declined greatly, and carbon isotope evidence in the rock record indicates the major productivity decline during this time. Planktonic forams, after having major success in the Cretaceous, majorly declined during this extinction event, and only a few species survived and then started to dominate again in the Cenozoic era. Ammonoids, which you guys know are cephalopods that were major players in the oceans of the Cenozoic, which included rudis, which are also mollusks, which were the dominant reef-building organisms in the Cretaceous due to ocean chemistry at the time, which I talk about in the Cretaceous world or life in the Cretaceous video. I'll link it up here if you want to check it out. And of course, our major vertebrates of the Mesozoic and Cretaceous specifically, like the marine reptile predators, the mosasaur, the plesiosaur, and of course, our dinosaurs. So what was it that set off the series of events that caused these major extinctions? Well, I'm sure the most common thing you've heard about this extinction event is the impact of a huge asteroid around 12 kilometers or 6 miles wide that hit Earth around 66 million years ago, and it altered the climate and environments on Earth to the point of mass extinction. There's plenty of evidence for this impact, including worldwide correlation among the rock record of a layer of iridium, which is only common in extraterrestrial material, shocked grains, microspherules, and microscopic diamonds, which are all grain types that only form under immense heat and pressure, such as that associated with an asteroid impact, and of course, the crater. It was actually years after this hypothesis was made that we found the crater, and this was really the smoking gun for this hypothesis. I mean, it pretty much proved, okay, yeah, that did happen. The question we'll answer later in the video, however, is how much extinction the actual impact actually caused versus the climatic consequences of the impact, which actually caused the extinctions. So we'll get to that later. But the other evidence I want to point out first is that both the amount of iridium in the rock record layer at this time in Earth's history and the size of the crater, which we can measure because we found it around 200 kilometers in diameter, both give us an estimate of the asteroid size. And in fact, both estimates from iridium and crater size around 10 kilometers or 6 miles wide. And radiometric dating with argon indicates the timing of this impact was around 66 million years ago, which is in agreement with the mass extinctions in the fossil record. Additionally, the material indicative of the impact, like microspherules, microscopic diamonds, and shocked grains, are thicker in their deposits closer to the crater, indicating where the pressure and temperature took place, which was at the crater site. And species living in proximity to the impact location were more heavily devastated by this mass extinction event. But it was really the aftermath of the impact that caused most of the mass extinctions. Now, it's not just one thing that happened after the impact, warming or cooling. It was actually a multitude of things that happened over different timescales during this time right after the impact. And these included, which we'll talk more about individually in more detail, darkness, the boil, fire, refrigeration, greenhouse, and acid rain. So let's talk about these first. We'll start with darkness. Dust and aerosols were thrown into the atmosphere, blocking sunlight for several months as a result of the impact of the asteroid. And this darkness and blocking of sunlight would have devastated photosynthesizers and therefore everything that relied on them, which was most things, especially macroorganisms that breathe the oxygen that they provided and macroorganisms that ate plants. The second part of the aftermath was the boil. As microspherules, or little rock fragments, settled after being blasted into the atmosphere, Earth was baked momentarily from the heat associated with the reentry of these particles, and it brought Earth's surface to the broiling temperature of an oven. Marine organisms weren't as heavily affected by this as terrestrial ones were because of the heat capacity of water and the large volume of the ocean. So this would have heavily affected those living on land. Like, if we were around, we would have been broiled, which is terrifying. The other thing this bake would have caused in this intense heat during this time immediately after impact would have been wildfires raging across the Americas, devastating any forest or grassland ecosystems. However, heat wasn't the only thing that was devastating environments on Earth at the time. After the brief boil event, cooling would have set in for several months due to the lack of sunlight because it was being blocked by dust and aerosols. Remember, microspherules and larger rock fragments settled and re-entered, causing the heat associated with the boil event. However, smaller particles like dust and aerosols would have stayed and blocked sunlight for a longer period and settled way later. And this caused several months of lack of sunlight, leading to what's called the impact winter, what was a major cooling period at the time. But after the brief boil and then after the several month long winter came global warming. CO2 was released in major quantities from the 3 kilometer thick carbonate deposit that the asteroid penetrated. The volume of carbonate that was penetrated gives us estimates of CO2 released that would have raised Earth's temperature by 7 degrees Celsius. However, warming subsided after a few hundred thousand years as increased weathering rates removed CO2 from the atmosphere once again, bringing it back to its near normal or pre-impact CO2 levels and temperatures. And the last bit of impact aftermath was acid rain. The asteroid impacted more than just carbonates. Sulfate evaporites like gypsum and barite were impacted, also releasing oxides and sulfur into the atmosphere, where they reacted with water and formed sulfuric acid rain. Increased CO2 from the carbonates would have also increased carbonic acid rain, and this was a mixture of acid rain that just wasn't great for the life on Earth that time and would have contributed heavily to the extinctions. The other thing it caused, which we can actually map today, are sinkholes surrounding the impact site. In fact, there's like a ring, almost a perfectly circular ring of sinkholes surrounding the Chicxulub crater that were formed due to the limestone dissolution after the impact caused fractures in the rock, allowing acid rain to seep deep into the sediment and dissolve it from below and cause these sinkholes to form. So that is all the aftermath of the impact, but some scientists have also hypothesized that the volcanism associated with the Deccan Traps in peninsular India played a role in this major mass extinction event. But more recent evidence suggests that the timing just isn't right. Recent studies estimate that these volcanoes would have been erupting during a period of around 500,000 to 100,000 years before the major impact and extinction event of the end Cretaceous. So the Deccan volcanism likely didn't cause the mass extinction or even play a major role in causing it, but it may have contributed to the decline of some species leading up to the event, making them less likely to survive the impact and impact aftermath, climate and environmental changes. But after the event, there is good news. There were major comebacks, especially in angiosperms or flowering plants and mammals, which of course matters a lot to us, because if that hadn't happened, if the dinosaurs still dominated terrestrial landscapes, we never would have evolved. As I talked about in my Cretaceous World video, the mammals were forced to remain really small, like rodent size, during most of the Mesozoic. It wasn't until the dinosaurs diminished that mammals were allowed to flourish. So that's the bright side to this extinction event, at least in our case and angiosperm's case and many of other species that were able to come back and flourish after in the Cenozoic. But there's also more bad news. Yes, this is kind of a gloomy video. This mass extinction event, which was caused by a major impact, serves as a major warning. The consequences of an asteroid impact like the one that hit Earth around 66 million years ago are eerily similar to the consequences consequences of nuclear war, which unfortunately, and I never thought I'd say this, is relevant today. Large particles blasted into the atmosphere would have baked Earth upon reentry, just like the boil event after the asteroid impact at the end of the Cretaceous. Dust and soot from explosions and fires would have also darkened the skies, causing what's called a nuclear winter rather than impact winter, but the same concept. And massive death of humans and other species would occur due to this type of scenario, obviously. So it does kind of give us insight into what might happen if nuclear war were to break out. And it's not just as simple as explosions. There's major climatic and environmental consequences that happen in the aftermath of such impacts that are even worse than the actual impacts, because impact devastation is local, and aftermath impact, climate, and environment devastation can spread globally, as it did at the end of the Cretaceous. If you guys want to check out related videos about the Cretaceous, such as life during the Cretaceous period and the shifting of the continents during the Cretaceous and how that affected climate, you can check out those videos. They're probably out by the time you're watching this. And if you want to see videos about other times throughout Earth's history, you can check out my historical geology playlist, which is right here in the screen, or will show up at some point on the screen for you to click and go check out. And lastly, for my reference for this and other videos in my historical geology playlist, I'm using the Earth System History book that is linked in my description down below if you want to check it out, as well as other minor and supporting references are in my description. So that is it for today's video, and I will see you guys next time. Thanks so much for watching. Bye.